Thank you, our Father, for your goodness to us, your gentleness to us, your kindness to us. We thank you that the Word of God is for us a treasure chest that is unfathomable, that we can never exhaust this divine thesaurus. We thank you for this. We pray that your Word might unfold its riches to us. And in this homiletics class, we might be enabled by your grace more and more to know the mind of the Spirit as we preach from the Word of God and develop our sermons accordingly. Bless our class tonight, we pray. Make it an enjoyable and profitable time. We commit this to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We are tonight dealing with three types of sermons: topical sermons, textual sermons, expository sermons, and the next class we'll deal with topical sermons. The class after that, textual sermons, and the class after that, expository sermons. So we're simply introducing them this evening. You all have read your assignment, I trust. If you have, then you know that John Broaddus has come into his own on pages 288 to 318. It's a very good survey of the three types of sermons and their distinctives, and I think very helpful. It's a little old, that textbook, but he's very helpful. This is his outstanding part of these books, where he's able to deal with these issues. Any questions or comments on, I have a page of comments on Broaddus here, and he spent more time on expository sermons. I'm glad that he did, because I tend to be more expository than topical or textual. It is my thinking that textual sermons, for various reasons, are the most difficult. And I would rather preach a topical message or what we would call an expository message. Lloyd-Jones, page 205 to 223, he is more given to expository messages and series. But he put great emphasis on what? There he comes back to it constantly. He puts great emphasis on it. I think he was reacting to much of the British preaching of his day in the early part of the 20th century. The form of the sermon. The form of the sermon. It has to have a sermonic form. And the temptation, the tendency, is that in expository preaching, if you're preaching through a book of the Bible, you have a tendency to have a running commentary verse by verse. What's wrong with a running commentary going through the book of the Bible? Nothing if you're teaching a lesson, but if you're preaching, there's something different about preaching. More than teaching, there's an emotional element. The whole personality is geared up and enters into that. There's an emotional element. There's a creative element. And so you have this sermonic form. And when we talk about a sermonic form, we imply three things. Anyone hazard a guess? You must begin with what?
Introduction.
An introduction. And in that introduction, you have to encapsulate what the message is going to be about. You don't say, well, tonight we're going to do an exegesis of Romans chapter 6, 7, and 8. And you think it's going to be a long evening, or he doesn't have any idea what he's talking about. That's about the richest section of Scripture one could imagine. So in the introduction, especially a topical message, and we'll deal with that in a few minutes, in a topical message, we want to deal with the subject of sanctification. You think, wow. In that introduction, you have to define and you have to draw the parameters of what you're going to say. Because you could go anywhere, the doctrine of sanctification, it's the most inclusive doctrine of Scripture. So you would, in your introduction, you would limit the subject. We want to deal with this aspect, that aspect. Then you're ready to go in and develop it according to its points. and the point should be progressive, and then the third thing is you need a conclusion. That's a sermonic form. That's what Lloyd-Jones means when he says that a sermon should have form. A running commentary doesn't have an introduction, perhaps, could go anywhere in its points, and does not come to a conclusion. Now, if you're teaching, say that we're teaching here at the 10 o'clock, which Brother Paul is really preaching, each of his messages comes to a conclusion and often an evangelistic appeal. See, it progresses up to a point, emotionally to a point, doctrinally to a point, practically to a point. That means it's sermonic in its form. It's just not a running commentary. I knew one preacher who was very good at preaching doctrinal series, and he would say to his congregation, "We'll stop at this point. We'll take up right here tonight in our night service." Well, that's not really preaching, because it doesn't come to a conclusion. At a certain point in time, history, and experience, you stand before a group of people and you have a message from God to deliver to them. And there's a purpose in that. I hope there's a purpose in it, not just to show that you know Greek and Hebrew and can quote various poets and Puritans and so, but you are there to edify Christians, you are there to evangelize the unsaved, you are there, and that, so when you introduce your message, this you bear in mind, that this message is to achieve something. It's to open people's minds, it's to teach them on this passage of scripture or this subject. Then when you come to the conclusion, you are pointing them to Christ, you are urging them to faith. There is something that gives it a sermonic form. In fact, your various points may not be that important as long as there is a progression toward that conclusion. That's what would separate, in my thinking, preaching from mere teaching. Many preachers teach because it's easier. It doesn't demand the powers of concentration and their emotional life. Everything is stirred up to this one thing, this appeal. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes it a sermon. Amen. So it's this form. And Lloyd-Jones is always, I start to say harping on this, not the term I want to use because it's necessary. But he's very much preoccupied with form, form, form. And I think because of many of the preachers that he dealt with in his day. Spurgeon, pages 70 through 80 of his book. Preaching, he starts out with, preaching must contain teaching. And of course, Spurgeon was a topical preacher. And sometimes he would take a text and says, we'll look at our text in three different ways. And those were his three points. Sometimes there were three possible meanings to the text, and he would make them three points. And he was very good at allegorizing and spiritualizing the text. On one occasion he said, we will lengthen the cords and let our vessel drift a bit this morning. And he was way out there, but it was good. I mean, if it's still good and it's still solid preaching, that's wonderful. Most of us don't have that gift. We are fighting against the current to keep our thoughts together. When young men start preaching and they're called upon to preach or they have an appointment to preach and they're young and relatively inexperienced, they get up and it's almost always topical preaching because it takes less preparation. It shouldn't. Topical preaching takes a tremendous amount of preparation because you must master your subject before you can expose the subject point by point. So you must have a mastery of it. But most people think that, well, you just get up and you say a few things and that's sufficient. And most men, they hurry from this text to that text, to this verse, to that verse, and they want to give everything from Genesis to Revelation in one sermon. And so oftentimes it's very scattered. It lacks cohesiveness, you see. And sometimes it lacks teaching. There's a tendency, I grew up in fundamentalist Christianity. That was my experience, that was my schooling, although I rebelled against it. Just throw scriptures at people, and you make a statement, and you have all sorts of proof text. You follow it with all sorts of proof text, And you give them scripture after scripture after scripture after scripture. And I can remember sitting under that type of preaching, and I think, well, I'm being beaten down with passages of scripture, but I wish that the preacher would back off and explain a couple of these. Feed me and open these scriptures and get right down to that heart level that was needful, because sometimes it's rather shallow, just bang, 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 and away you go. But most preaching, when preachers start out, is topical preaching, because they have so much in their mind and they have this youthful enthusiasm, and they just sort of take a scattergun approach and they just shoot all over the place. Scripture here and a scripture there. Their mind takes them here, their mind takes them there, and so forth. It's like a dog chasing three cats. And it could be preaching. I say this when I consider that some of you men are street preachers. That's very difficult. It's very difficult, because no matter how organized you might be, you might get people for a minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, and that's all. They stop, they listen, they look at you, and they walk off. Or they stand and cuss you out, or they do something else. But they're getting bits and pieces, unless God holds them there for the entire message. And every type of preaching has its difficulty. Spurgeon begins, though, that preaching is to contain teaching. And Lloyd-Jones says this, so does Spurgeon, there has to be a connection between the text and the sermon. And if you're going to apply something that happened 3,000 years ago in Pharaoh's court, or the court of David, almost 4,000 years ago in Pharaoh's court, you have to give in your introduction the historical circumstances. And then when that's settled, so your text is stabilized, then you take your subject from that, then you can preach it and you can develop it and you can apply it, you see. But if you don't make that historical connection, the people won't make it. Then we have to consider, I've lost my notes a long time ago, my place in them. You have to consider the educational level of your congregation. And we have a much more educated people, thinking people, than we did years and years ago. You have to be, what can I say, intelligent, and you have to be cogent in your thinking. You have to guide their thinking. Guide them here. Guide them to where you want them to be so they're prepared for the message itself. And that means oftentimes in the Bible, if it's a practical subject, if it's an instant in the Bible, first one that comes to my mind, and the iron did swim. Was it Elisha? The axe head was lost when they went out to build the new prophetic chambers, and he threw the twig out there and the iron floated to the top. Alas, my master, for it is borrowed. And the iron did swim. And I think Spurgeon has a tremendous message on that, that God upsets and overrules the laws of nature in the realm of grace. Oh, you could go forever on that. But the iron did swim. That it's attractive, you know. But then you have to tell what happened. That the place where the sons of the prophets were in the days of Elijah was too confining. So they said, let's go out and we'll build and enlarge our place. So they took every man his axe and they went out and hewed wood and they built a bigger building. One man went out and the axe head flew off. And he says to Elijah, alas, my master, for it was borrowed. So he owes for the axe head. Elijah puts a twig out there, throws it in the water, and the iron swims to the surface, and he picks it up. The iron did swim, and that's a tremendous text. It's an attractive text of God overruling the laws of nature in the realm of grace. Yes, you can go, and of course, that's what Spurgeon says. You have to get to the gospel. And he was more of an evangelistic preacher than Lloyd-Jones or Broaddus. Because he was always evangelizing. In a settled congregation, Sunday after Sunday, the question is asked, should I always be evangelistic? Well, yes, if you know your church members well enough, you know that some of them need to be saved. The ones that give you trouble, of course. But seriously, and I am serious, you may have a lot of visitors. Good opportunity to evangelize. Then you want to feed the people of God. Continually evangelistic preaching without feeding God's people stunts the ministry. There has to be some way to keep the people there, because they get tired of, you can't get tired of the gospel, but you need something for your soul. You say, here I am, my children are unruly, my wife's about ready to leave me, my heart is hurting, the whole family's in an uproar, I've just lost my job, and the preacher's beating me over the head because I'm not out soul winning 20 hours a week. Give me something for my heart, my soul, and my family. So there has to be a balance, you see, in that way. But Spurgeon states that the true value of the sermon is the truth that it contains. So there's a difference between being an evangelist and being the pastor of a settled congregation. Most of the time, much of the time, you're going to be feeding God's people. It's good to have a gospel appeal. A good message lends itself in some way to a gospel appeal. Mm-hmm. Even my sermon Sunday might have had a gospel appeal to it. We were dealing with lies in Scripture. We're dealing with the ninth commandment. Lies in Scripture. I listed 15 of them that are subjects of controversy. The Bible records these lies. Some of them were bad lies. Some of them were good lies. Some of them God blessed. And I then dealt with the principles involved. God is absolutely righteous. Therefore, whatever God commands is right. We have to be able to deal with that. Not only so, but truth is relative to God. Truth is not relative. It's relative to God. We're not relativists. We're absolutists. But truth is not absolute. Truth is relative to God. And when God contramands his law and command, he does it for a purpose. God is absolutely righteous. Therefore, whatever God commands is right. It was a righteous act for Hosea to marry a whore because God commanded him to marry a whore, to love her, to have children by her, and then when she left him for her other lovers, to buy her back out of the slave market and love her again. And all of that is quite contrary to the seventh commandment. That's right. But it was righteous because God commanded it. He had to live his ministry to Israel. His whole life was assigned to Israel. Do you think he was brokenhearted? I don't think he was cold or calloused about the matter. I'm sure that the nation looked upon him as a gutless man without backbone and criticized him. Many of these prophets had to live out their ministry. It was a terrible thing. But I had to deal with these principles, the difference between biblical faith and moralism. The moralist says, I cannot lie. Truth is absolute. And he finds fault with God, who commends lies in Scripture in certain instances and blesses the people who lied. You have to come to terms with either biblical faith or moralism. A man stands in the imputed righteousness of Christ with a biblical faith. The moralist stands in his own self-righteousness. I had to deal with poetic justice. Poetic justice teaches, and it's not scriptural, it's pagan, that all right will be rewarded and all wrong will be punished in this life. If that's true, there's no need for a final day of judgment. So you have to reason these things out. And we've lost families out of the church over this type of preaching. I said, you mean to tell me that you believe it's sinful and deceptive for military to wear camouflage? Yes, they should wear red coats like the British did in the Revolutionary War. That's what he said. I backed him up into that corner. With the white stripes this way to use as a crosshairs for those muskets? Yes. I said, even nature. God uses deceit in nature. How many of you know anything about butterflies? It's a good manly subject. Viceroy butterfly. Have you ever seen a viceroy butterfly? It looks something like a monarch butterfly, but it's not a monarch butterfly. A monarch butterfly is very bitter to birds of prey, to these birds that go around and kill and eat these butterflies when they migrate. The monarch is bitter, so the birds don't eat the monarch butterfly. The viceroy butterfly is not quite the same, but enough to fool the birds. That's deception. That's in God. Look at the predators with spots and stripes. God camouflages them. That's part of creation. Well, we lost the family anyway. But we have to deal with it. So how did I end up with my message? Have you come to terms with the God of the Bible? The only thing to do is submit to him and rest in him and rest in the righteousness of Christ. Spurgeon said there's 1,000 ways in every text to get to the gospel. So I didn't understand that when I was in this fundamentalist Bible college, but I attended a church and I could not believe what the pastor would preach on a Sunday morning. Everybody was evangelistic. I mean, decidedly evangelistic. It was a gospel sermon. He was preaching on other subjects. He was even preaching to Christians on a Sunday morning. And I thought, that's astounding. But he would always come to a gospel conclusion. And I said, I'm learning something about preaching. He's dead now. He passed away years ago. I'm talking about a generation when I was in my mid-20s. I'm a little older than that now by about 50-some years. But I respected him, and it was always good. It was always good. He was a fundamentalist, though. He preached one Sunday morning on the doctrine of election. I thought, some of the people called him a hyper-Calvinist. He preached, it was a weak sermon on election, but it was from the heart, and it was a good message. And that night, he preached on, God has faith in you. And my theology professor who attended that church said, oh, boys, he said, my pastor, he preached like a Presbyterian in the morning and like a Methodist at night. But at any rate, but he was a great man, very kindly toward me. He knew what I believed. And when I left over doctrine, left the school and took my bride and moved to Texas to teach in a Calvinistic school, he was very supportive. He was always a good friend, and I respected him. But for the first time, I learned that you can preach a message to Christians and end with an evangelistic appeal, and it all fits together. Mm-hmm. And that is indeed the blessing of God. So now, what was the usual? And Lloyd-Jones mentions this, and it was his practice in his early days. What's the usual practice in Britain? Is traditional in Britain. You preach to Christians in the morning and your evangelistic ministry is at night. The opposite of what we would have here. Why is that? Because you had the state church, the Anglican church, and they only had one service, and that was in the morning. So the Anglicans, if they had any spiritual desire, would wander around to the nonconformist churches in the evening. That's when they had the real gospel preaching. How many people did the 3 K's of the 17th century among the Baptists?
Knowles.
Keach, Benjamin Keach. Keach, Knowles, and
Kiffin.
Kiffin's my man. He was a wine merchant. The King of England wanted to borrow £30,000 from him. He gave him £10,000. William Kiffin was a Baptist preacher, lived into his 90s. Maybe had a glass of his product every day, I don't know. But at any rate, he lived into his 90s. He gave the King of England £10,000. He said, I've saved myself £20,000 and my neck. Because when the king borrowed that much money from me, had you put you in the tower for being a nonconformist and cut your head off. But Benjamin Keach wrote a hymnal. He spent a lot of his time pilloried in the stocks for being an unlicensed preacher. And he had a congregation of how many people? Come on, my Baptist historians. 150. So he built a large wooden tabernacle and he packed it out every Sunday night. How many people did that wooden tabernacle hold for his Sunday night meetings? 1,150. He packed it out. All the Anglicans would come and hear him preach. So it was traditional in Britain to have the evangelistic sermon on Sunday night and feeding, teaching the believers on Sunday morning. Exactly the opposite as we would do here in our society. It's here people visit on Sunday morning, don't come back on Sunday night. They're looking for a church or they need to be evangelized. So we have more teaching, preaching on Sunday night, more evangelism on Sunday morning. Just a thought. Now, let's see what we can do here. Number one, or two in my notes here, one does not begin by determining what type of sermon he's going to preach. You don't say, you know, I'm scheduled to preach this next Sunday. I wonder if I'll preach a topical message, a textual message, or an expository message. We don't think like that. We're concentrating on the types of sermons, but we don't think like that. What determines what kind of sermon? Two things determines what type of sermon it will be, topical, textual, or expository. What two things will determine this?
Your audience?
That's the third one. Good. And that does.
The Holy Spirit?
That is introductory A.
Text.
Text and subject. Because once we get the text, and then that text presents us with a subject, we might say, this is better fitted to a topical message, or it's better fitted to a textual message if God has given us a special text and laid it on our heart. We can open the text from that. Or it's an expository message that the whole context of our immediate text is so good that we must deal with the whole thing, and then we end up preaching three or four or five messages on it, you see. So basically, the text and the subject, that's classroom notes. Yes, the Holy Spirit leads us to a text or a subject. God lays something on our hearts. There's something indefinite about being a preacher, hopefully. There's something that's spiritual about it. There's something about the Lord's impressed me with this or the Lord's impressed me with that. Do I have the leadership of the Lord in that? Now, if you're a topical preacher, you can be all over the place. You can labor with this all week. If you're an expository preacher, next Sunday, what are you going to deal with? Colossians chapter 3?
Long-suffering.
Long-suffering. There it is. He's preaching through the book of Colossians now. So he knows what his subject is and has some idea of how he's going to develop. And these messages are really good, very rich, except for being convicting. They're really enjoyable. But it's good. And a topical message really won't deal with that much unless you have a specific text that you want to deal with. So the text and the subject, expository messages or series of messages. Can you have a topical sermon that becomes a series? Yes. Farrell Griswold was my preacher. Of all the preachers I've ever heard, I've heard perhaps greater preachers than he, more disturbing preachers. The one man that has really frightened me a couple of times is Rolf Barnard. And when you were there in the church building and he was preaching and you were there, not just listening on a tape or sermon, you were there in that atmosphere. It was disconcerting at times. You had to get up after the message, go out someplace and pray. There was power. He shot from the hip. Yes, he was all over the place. highly educated and very penetrating at times. I had a tape of one of his rough messages. He didn't have any that weren't rough. And I gave them to a Presbyterian minister friend of mine who just died this last year. I had known him for, close to 40 years. And I said, here's a sermon by a rough-hewn Baptist preacher. We were on carpool and my children were small, so this had to be, 36, 37 years ago at least. So the next week we met for carpool, we're standing out there. He hands me the tape back. I said, what did you think? He said, that man was a prophet. He was aware of this power, that there was something above and beyond Barnard's personality in that message. There was a force, there was a power, there was a conviction, there was something there. It just wasn't the man. It wasn't his presentation, it wasn't his delivery, it wasn't his shouting, glory, or anything like that in his southern style. There was something else that was there. And we would call it the anointing of God. There was power at times in his preaching. And you witnessed this in this atmosphere of preaching. But we have the text, we have the subject, and we might wrestle with these. God might move us toward a certain text. It might come to us in a very strange way. If you preach, as I said, topical messages, you may wrestle all week. If you have your text, you may wrestle all week with, what am I going to do with it? When we deal with topical messages in our next session, I'm going to take and list several texts, and then I'm going to develop a subject from each of these texts, just as examples. One will be, I think, on sanctification. I'm going to give two outlines on sanctification. What if you are impressed that you're going to preach on the doctrine of sanctification? Well, it's possible to preach on the doctrine of sanctification in one message, but it's going to be very shallow. Positional sanctification, definitive sanctification, practical and progressive sanctification. You have 3 points. But each of these could be a series of messages in itself. So if I were thinking about preaching on sanctification, I would have to make it a series. It would be a topical series because there is no one text. That's the perfect text for it. That's the right text for it, I might say. It is such a broad subject, so you would list the various aspects of the doctrine and give a message or two to each one. I'll try to develop that for the next lecture. But you don't know. You have a text, you have a subject. There's something that God's laid on your heart. You look at the needs of the congregation. You perhaps have a family that's bringing some unsaved family members there. You have people from a certain cult that are at loose ends now trying to come to biblical truth, maybe new converts. There's something that's going to lead you in some way. You have the text, you have the subject. How are you going to develop that? That will determine whether you'll have a topical message, a textual message, or an expository message. Next consideration, many tend toward topical sermons because these seem to take less preparation and give much more freedom. My contention is that a topical message, if approached as it should be, takes a tremendous amount of preparation because a topical message deals with a subject. You're dealing with a subject, doctrinal or practical, and you must in some way master that subject. You must be certain you don't leave pieces and ends of it here and there that ought to be mentioned. And when you do preach on it, if you're going to do it in one message, the introduction has to include all of these, saying there are 6 or 7 aspects to the subject we take this morning. This, 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 and this. I intend to deal with this. Then you've done your job. You have surveyed it so people have some concept of the biblical teaching inclusively, and then the one point or the one aspect that you're going to deal with in that message. If not, then you might say that in the next few messages God did, we'll deal with these various aspects. That enables you to preach a series and to get to some depth. Much preaching is shallow preaching, and it fails to get down to, can we say, the heart level of the hearers. So what happens if that happens? What happens if the preaching is rather shallow and they get 5 or 6 verses thrown at them, or 15 or 20 and a couple of stories thrown at them? Then what happens?
They don't remember it.
The preacher has a 45-minute altar call when he uses all sorts of things to do what he should be doing in preaching. They said, well, at the end of your preaching, don't you exhort men to Christ? I said, I try to do it in the sermon. I don't have to add anything. If you have to add something to the sermon is incomplete. And sometimes we have stories, we have a few verses here and there. We hear men wandering about hither and yon. Then it's time for the invitation, and then they concentrate on certain issues and so forth, many of which have nothing to do with the sermon at all. And there's all this disjuncture. We have to be concerned about the text. We have to be concerned about the subject. These two things will determine if our message will be a topical message, a textual message, or an expository message. So preaching a topical message necessitates much preparation for its form, its content, its arrangement, and its progression. I usually find myself on Sunday morning here about 8 o'clock. I try to get here by 8 o'clock because my computer and printer are here. And I've been up since well before daylight, and I've gone through, I've marked up my notes. On Saturday night, I've gone out, taken a folding chair, sat out on the sidewalk in the dark in front of my house in my bathrobe and slippers, looking up at the stars or enjoying the fog and praying and coming back in, and things aren't right. Sunday morning, things aren't right. It's a wonderful thing when your sermon looks entirely different on Sunday morning, and you say, point two should be point three. You draw a line down there. Then I have to get over here, redo everything over. Now it fits because it's been developing throughout the week. And sometimes you look at it and you get this revelation. This is the progression that I need. And you simply haven't seen it before. You put in your study, you put in your time. All of a sudden, it doesn't look right. This should be here, that logical progression. And that's needful in topical preaching because your subject must progress toward a conclusion. And you don't want to have a strong point here and finish with a weak point there that's sort of off kilter and sort of thrown in. Then the preaching, the sermon sort of dies. It's the work of God. It's the Spirit of God. And working in your personality, and you know when things begin to come together. It's a very strange thing. People might say, well, you know, that wasn't a very good sermon. Oh, really? Well, why wasn't it a good sermon? I can say this if somebody else is preaching, Pastor Paul's preaching, I'd say, well, they don't say that, by the way. But if they did, I would say, well, what do you think was wrong with it? Well, it really made me feel badly. Well, that's good. That's good. Unless you're absolutely perfect, you should feel badly about some things, should be convicted about some things. Preaching is meant to make a change in our lives. Or sometimes people say, man, I am just, praise God, praise God. Really, what was so unusual about the sermon? We've been visiting church after church. We finally come here and heard the truth. Praise God. We didn't think we'd find a decent church in this area. So there it is, that logical development. All right, textual sermons are often difficult because the major points must derive from the text. Well, what if the text doesn't have a logical development in it? And you have two or three points or four points to your message, and you may just have to go to the first of the text, the last of the text, and the middle of the text last. And explain to the people that way because of, don't tell them this is necessary for logical progression. I think they'll be able to follow you in that. Spurgeon, and I hope to find one to use as an example, he would take a text at times and look at it in three different ways. I've never seen anybody else do that, but he could do it. And when you read that message, 10, 12 pages long, you'd say, wow, this is awesome. This was the power of his mind. If he weren't a preacher, he could have been the prime minister. He had a photographic memory. So did Luther, so did Calvin. There were about 30 men during the time of the Reformation who were of genius quality. Many of them had photographic memories. Does anyone here know who Olivetan was during the Reformation? Olivetan. Calvin's cousin. Olivetan wasn't his name. He had a French name. Why did they call him Olivetan? He burned the midnight oil. He's known as Olivetan. Olive oil lamp. Quite a student. And he wrote a translation of the New Testament for the Waldenses. And Calvin wrote the foreword to it. It was his first writing as a believer. But all of Vetney burned the midnight oil. So you can add, as all of the Muslims have Mohammed in their name, once your brother put all of Vetten in your name and burn the midnight oil. All right. But you have to have from the text a progression of thought. And that's difficult. For me, textual sermons have always been the most difficult. I've always tried to take a bigger text and just an expository approach. That's my tendency of my personality. Textual or expository sermons are the best when preaching through a lengthy passage or a book of the Bible. The major issue in this approach is that each sermon retains its form and not simply become a running commentary without introduction, culmination, and conclusion. That's the one thing to guard against, that each message, each segment in a series is sermonic in its form, because you may have a person be there one time. They should get that sermon with that message be impressed upon them and not just leave it for another time. Then what do you have? You have lectures. I preached the best I could one Sunday morning. This has got to be, it's 21, 22 years for us here, so it has to be about 30, 35 years ago in another church where I was for 20 years. And I preached, it was an exposition. I was enjoying myself in opening up a passage of scripture, and we were going to have several messages on it. And I would preach for an hour because cassette tapes were an hour long. I try to cut myself down now to 40 minutes and not be so lengthy as I used to be. It's simply better for the retention of the people, and you don't try to keep them awake the last 20 minutes. You know, the mind begins to fatigue after a while. And sometimes the preacher's tired, and you can tell his sermon sort of has fringes on. It's coming apart at the edges, and you're coming apart at the edges, and you go, oh man. I remember my dad one night at a Bible conference. I love my dad. Been dead 33 years now. He was preaching at a Bible conference, and he was pretty meaty. He just laid it out. 45 minutes into the message, he said, that was my introduction. I went, Lord, I hope he can hold this thing together. And he did well. That was a great night. It was at a camp, and the screens were down, the doors were open, and big moths were flying around. And my dad would go pick off a moth, spit another one out. And it really kept your attention, but it was exciting preaching. But he was laying it out, and I thought, what? It was a great message. He said, and that was my introduction. And we do things like that at times. Well, then preach a series, you know. And sometimes a series begins with an introductory message where you lay everything out. That's good when you have a settled congregation and you know that people are going to be on that occasion and the next occasion and the next occasion. But oftentimes, if we have people coming and going, especially unsaved people, and you want to reach them and face them with the truth of the gospel, you have to keep that sermonic form and always come to a conclusion. All right, doctrinal sermons tend to be topical sermons, as the form is determined by the specific doctrine addressed. If the doctrine is broad or general, it would be wise to develop the subject into a series of sermons. And today, there's a lot of counseling from the pulpit. I see that with TV preachers and so forth. How to live a victorious life, or how to find comfort. You think, oh my, you know, they're going to give a Sunday school lesson. And maybe it's good, maybe it's necessary. But we want something that has some doctrinal teeth to it. We want something, the more biblical it is, the more we will be taught, and the more nourishing it is. I'm supposed to be on a low-carbohydrate diet. I try to eat, you know, high-protein diet. I feel really good on it. I need to lose weight. My wife's Italian, so you know how that goes. A lot of pasta that you have to cut out and try to cut down on and so forth. And what can I say? But when they thin out the soup because company's coming, you don't want to do that with the preaching.
Amen.
Don't thin out the soup. Feed the people. Feed the people. There's a book entitled Feed My Sheep, and it has some good things in it. But sometimes people say, you know, we're being starved to death. And you think, that's unforgivable. That's unforgivable. We have the whole Bible. I mean, we have over 31,000 verses of scripture. We should be able to bring out something that's meaty, something that's practical, something that will speak to a person's heart or soul. On one occasion, Arthur Pink was, I just finished reading his life, the life of Arthur Pink for the third time, the book by
Ian Murray,
yeah. The second edition of it. I read the first edition once, second edition twice. And just going through to review some things about Arthur Pink. And a man came up to him once and said, I was converted under your ministry some time ago. And Pink asked him, he says, what was the occasion? And the man told him that he remembered the message. And he said, that's strange, I was preaching to Christians. But you don't know what God's going to do. And sometimes, and Spurgeon had talked about this in our last lecture's reading, that it may be the verse of a hymn. Does anyone know about the conversion of B.H. Carroll, the great Baptist giant of Texas? B.H. Carroll, in fact, he was 6'4", beard down to his waist, B.H. Carroll, Confederate soldier, Texas Ranger, top debater in the county, and then converted. Oh, my. The Baptist Colossus. I have a book by that title. Sort of a hatchet job, but I love B.H. Carroll. We're born on the same date, December 27th. A few years apart, however, I want you to know that. But where was I going with this B.H. Carroll?
The hymn.
A hymn?
His hymn.
Ah, does anybody know the circumstances of his conversion?
No.
It was after the war. He had been wounded in the war. And he came back, was a Texas Ranger, and was a Texas Ranger, then went to the service, came back. They're in a Brush Arbor meeting, and his mother was praying for him. His father fathered 12 children, and his first wife died. He married again, and they adopted 13 more children. There were 25 children at his table. You're going to have to give his biography to your wife to read, just for interest. And they were at a Brush Arbor meeting. His mother was praying for him. His dad was a Baptist preacher. Here he was, home from the war, a great burden upon him and a great chip on his shoulder and everything. The Brush Arbor meeting was over. There was some wagons all pulled together there, and there was a fire. And there was a group of young ladies that stood around that fire and began to sing a hymn, and he was converted. Mm. Had endured the preaching and shut it out of his mind and everything. During the singing of that hymn, he was converted. That's a tremendous story. So you don't know. And you may be preaching to Christians, and you may be very burdened, and you may be doing the right thing. But God can save somebody under a message meant for Christians. That's the way God works. But we always want to serve up, you know, good meat, good spiritual meat, something that has good substance to it. Now, if the text is lengthy and a topical approach is attempted, then the introduction must cover the various issues of the text. We'll deal with that tonight, just in passing. Introductions necessitate great care. In introducing the various commandments of the Decalogue, I give a four-point introduction with almost every message because people come and go on Sunday mornings. I don't have the same congregation all the time. So I read, we're dealing with the ninth commandment now. And God spake all these words saying, I am the Lord thy God that delivered thee out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. I always read verses 1 and 2 with each of the commandments. It's my contention that that prologue should be read with each commandment. It should never be separated from them. And the reason is, it sets the true context that the commandments were given to a redeemed people to reflect God's moral character in their daily lives. It wasn't given to make men savable or to give them work salvation. And it's also framed in the second person singular like all of the commandments. God is addressing each individual person himself. Then, although 8 of the 10 commandments are framed in the negative, reflecting the fallen sinful condition of mankind, the biblical summary of the moral law is positive: love to God and love to one's neighbor. And then each commandment is an example of case law, forensically. In other words, in legal language, each commandment embraces a whole body of jurisprudence. The New Testament says, "He that hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him." So each commandment, though seemingly simple, embodies a tremendous amount of things. Every inclination, motivation of the heart is forbidden, and every inclination and motivation that is positive is commanded in these. It's just not simply the way it is. Jewish tradition by the time of our Lord was only of the overt act was forbidden, you see. But our Lord gave it. If a man looks upon a woman to lust after her, he's committed adultery with her already in his heart. He gives the true implications of God's law. And finally, the best commentary on the moral law of God is the remainder of Scripture, especially the New Testament. That settles the relevance and perpetuity of God's law. So I deal with that as we have people come to hear these things, because he's preaching on what? The Ten Commandments. What is he doing that for? Those are given to the Jews. New Covenant theology among the Baptists. And very strange things. And when we started our series on the Ten Commandments, where do you think we started? Romans chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. That the moral law of God is going to be the final day of judgment. That'll be the standard by which man is judged. Then we went through the entire New Testament and exegeted every relevant passage showing the perpetuity and relevance of God's law. Then we went back and started with the Ten Commandments. And there was no argument after that. Mm-hmm. And that's the way it ought to be, because the Bible is a unity. It's coherent. And properly exegeting these passages in the New Testament sheds a tremendous amount of light. So if you're going to take a text and you're going to preach a topical message, you have to grasp that in the introduction so people know what you're dealing with and how you're going to deal with it. All right. Much of the introduction will depend on the congregation or the listeners as to their doctrinal maturity, their educational backgrounds, or the given situation. If you're dealing with a lot of country folk, which I enjoy, well, your illustrations and everything will be different. And I was in Canada preaching in a country church, and I gave as an illustration Romans chapter 1, verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel." And I drew this picture of being in Africa flying a plane into a safari camp, and the plane crashes and we survive. And we look through there, we may be days before a party reaches us, and we scrounge around because there's a tremendous amount of very large predators in Africa. And we come up with a .22 caliber gun. I would be ashamed of that gun. I think the only thing it'd be good for is shoot a guinea hen for food. You're going to have leopards at night, lions at night and during the day, and all sorts of things. When I gave that illustration, I just had to close down the message because they're so anti-gun in Canada. All they heard was gun, firearm, and it was all over. So you have to understand this tremendous amount of prejudice. I used to talk here in different days about the war of Northern aggression. I'm a Southerner. the War of Northern Aggression, the so-called Civil War. No war is civil. It was the War of Northern Aggression. And it was fought basically in the South, except for Gettysburg. We have darker people attending here. I don't use that terminology anymore. I've been charged with being a racist. I've had to answer some bad letters written to me. All sorts of problems. Be careful. You know, we have to deal with our with what congregation we have. And in the South, why I still try to be discreet. But in the South, or preaching to country people, you can talk about shoeing horses. And I grew up on in a dairy. We had a cattle ranch, a dairy, and a farm. My dad had to be a mechanic, a blacksmith, a carpenter, and about everything else. It takes a tremendous amount of skill. I grew up with a lot of that. So I can talk to people and not embarrass myself too much. When you talk about people who live out in the sticks and work buck saws, and now they use chainsaws and so forth, know something about it. And we can identify with one another, and they'll understand. In other cases, with city people, it's a little more difficult. So it determines what type of people you're speaking to. At the rescue mission, don't think you're speaking to sinners. Those people in the rescue mission are filled with self-righteousness, and they all claim to know the Bible better than you do.
They do.
Yeah, they cry out, "That's not what it teaches." I was at one meeting one night. How many of you are there when they wanted to beat me up the one night down at down south at the rescue mission? This is quite a few years ago. We had two big men in the church that time. One had a 23-inch neck, great big fella. And I told him, I said, if he comes for me, I says, you get down behind him. I told the other big fella, I says, you push him over that and we'll all three tackle him. But this man stood up, and he was this wide. He was young. I mean, powerfully built. He was just, wow. He says, you're a liar. My father was a preacher. You're all liars. And I'm preaching, and I said, shut up and sit down. I'm preaching the gospel. Felt like Al Martin. And it went on like that for quite a while. But everybody would look at him. They'd look at me. They all listened anyway. Didn't have to worry about them falling asleep or so. I was sort of excited. I thought, wow, this is like the Apostle Paul, you know, or maybe someone in the Colosseum. But I went, and he finally just sat out and shut up. But the men there have been known to kick him down and kick him and leave him bloody and throw him out in the street. But he was too big. I mean, the staff, not our men. But yeah, it was an exciting time. So there you pick out a fairly simple gospel message and you deal with it. I'm going to speak at the rest home on Saturday. Brother Jim has been preaching for several months now on the Good Shepherd. The shepherd, I mean the good one, gives his life for the sheep. And I told him, I will try to follow with the 23rd Psalm. I haven't preached on the 23rd Psalm since 2009. That's almost seven years now. It's 2008. About 7 years since I preached there. It was February the 15th, 2008, that I preached that. And most of those people who preached then are already dead. Now I've got another crop of old people, but I'll be able to open up and just talk to them very kindly about Psalm 23. And I trust that it will go well, and I have a half an hour, and that they'll be able to follow. There are some things that they've never heard before that I'll make reference to keep their attention and give them the truth of the gospel. So I'm looking forward to that. It's be quite a time. Okay, we have a half an hour. We're going to, you have your notes. I'm gonna go through this very quickly on the notes. Some I've already dealt with here. These are just my page of notes, two pages that I've had. Number one, we've dealt with the sermon naturally derives either from the subject or the text. If topical, and I give some examples here of texts used to introduce the subject of revival. Suppose you're asked to go and preach on revival. I've been asked to do that with Jeff Rose coming next August. And do you know Baruch Mose?
No, I know of him.
He will be here that weekend at our church. He's going to be, I think, on a Sunday night. We're going to have a special meeting. He'll be at Emmanuel in Sacramento Sunday morning. We'll have to have a Sunday night situation for him. Going to be a busy weekend. But, and I'll probably take, it's possible I'll take one of these texts. These have been taken for years and years in times of revival. They're from the Old Testament. Well, the last one is from the New Testament. O Lord, I have heard thy speech and was afraid. O Lord, revive thy work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known. In wrath, remember mercy. This has been a famous text. This is Habakkuk. It's in the final chapter. His book is three chapters long. What he's seen is, prophetically, the Chaldeans. They were under Assyrian power at this time, but the Chaldeans were suddenly going to rise to power. They were going to come and invade. Why did the Chaldeans invade Palestine and come against Jerusalem? They were fighting the Assyrians. How did they possibly get down there? 605, yes, the second battle of Carchemish, 605 BC. Carchemish is way up on the border of what we today would call Turkey. And Pharaoh went all the way up there to meet. Nebuchadnezzar defeated him, chased him all the way down. When he came down there and took care of them, he conquered Jerusalem. That's the way God works. But at any rate, he saw all this. And the third chapter of Habakkuk is just awesome, because it concludes on a very high note. But here it's a plea for revival in the face of certain judgment. And if that can be encapsulated as an introduction, you have a very powerful contemporary message for the subject of revival. The second text has been used especially in the 1904 Welsh revival. Oh, that thou wouldst rend the heavens, that thou wouldst come down, that the mountains might flow down at thy presence. As when the melting fire burneth, the fire that causeth the waters to boil, to make known thy name known to thine adversaries, that the nations may tremble at thy presence. Lloyd-Jones himself makes use of this text several times in speaking of revival. And then Acts chapter 3, verse 19. This is the most famous text on revival, historically. Peter is preaching, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. When the times, kairoi, not chronos, kairoi, special set times of refreshing, that is reviving, shall come from the presence of the Lord. All of the old men, the Puritans, the evangelical leaders of the 18th century, and later, all looked upon this as a prophecy of future times of revival in this gospel economy. Maybe by application, I'm not sure, but they looked upon it as such. So, but you have it, and then you take the subject of revival. And how would you develop the subject of revival? Well, you could take, if you're dealing with people who are praying, people who are hungry for revival, people who believe that it's possible, even in the day in which we live, you might deal with the history of revival. Give a historical sketch of it. You might deal with some instances within times of revival. All of this is tremendously interesting because most people have very little knowledge of church history, and very few have any knowledge of the history of revival. Our prospectus has one whole class on the history of revival because it's lacking. But it's something to put some iron in your blood and stir you up. All right. I'm going to give two texts now. One is very short. One is very lengthy. And I've done this on purpose. Examples of texts used to introduce salvation by grace through faith. One text is short. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. I don't say verses 8 and 9 because the thought is incomplete. Should be at least verses 8 through 10 to have the complete thought. And the other is Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 17. For by grace you have been and continue in the state of salvation through faith. And that not of yourselves, of God, emphatically the gift. definitely not of works, lest any man should boast. For his workmanship we are, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. I've given you a little paraphrase of the Greek there. That would be a tremendous text in salvation by grace through faith. Salvation, grace, faith, the three cardinal terms of Christianity and Christian experience. And if you look at this in its context, it begins with the word for. Everything is finished in Ephesians chapter 2 at verse 7. Verses 8 through 10 are a doctrinal commentary and explanation on what Paul has just written. It's an explanation, and it sets it out, the doctrine of free and sovereign grace. Now look at Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 17. If you're familiar with Romans chapter 4, this is a lengthy text. It also deals with salvation by grace through faith. If you were to take the second one as your text, what would you have to do? In your introduction, you would have to deal with the different aspects. Survey that. Circumcision in Abraham. Abraham was circumcised as a believer. David, as an instance of free and sovereign grace, an adulterer and a murderer, but sin was not imputed to him. There's the freeness of God's grace. As against works mentality, you have the promise made to Abraham was not through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Abraham is the father of those who came, Jewishness through the law, and those who came from the Gentiles. All of this together, and you would have to sort of survey this passage and bring it together and then deal with the subject. So that's why it's difficult at times to take a more lengthy text and deal with it, and you have to deal with it as an introduction before you preach. You're able to do it, but you have to master the truth in that text to do it. Usually in a topical message, you take a shorter text. Spurgeon would take at times three or four words, four or five words, or Aaron's rod swallowed them up, something short like that, and then build everything around it, give the historical circumstances so people understand, and then hit your point. When every divine work is cast to the earth, it swallows up the works of wickedness, ungodliness, and so forth. Then you can just fly and preach on this, you see. So I would say take a shorter text. If you take the longer text, which is a good text, you have to come to terms with some of these issues, narrow it down. Now, a topical message on sanctification. Taking 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3, for this is the will of God, even your sanctification. The outline would be the introduction, the meaning and principle of sanctification, the outline, positional sanctification, definitive sanctification, practical and progressive sanctification. It's possible to bring that in one message. You can't have much depth to it, but you can survey the doctrine of sanctification. In our next lecture, God willing, I will give two outlines of sanctification to preach a topical message on it, but one will become a series. There's about 15 things, about 15 different aspects to adequately deal with the doctrine of sanctification. So you don't want to take a great subject and just make a few helter-skelter remarks about it, because you won't be able to deal adequately with it. And people might come up after the message, well, Pastor, why didn't you deal with this, and do you mean to say this, and they've completely misunderstood because you've left too many gaps. And you will have critical people if you have some good Bible students. It's not always bad to have some critical people. Just those who are well thought out and critical is better than those who simply blow up and make all sorts of objections to your preaching. It's an interesting thing. I preached a message once in a time of great controversy. I may have told you about this before, years and years ago at the church where you grew up. And I had meant to prove a point. And I took my text out of 2 Corinthians. And I read it, and then I developed my message, 4 or 5 points. And I vehemently preached. And after I was through preaching, it wasn't a church-splitting situation, but the church was facing an issue. The church was changing and going in a different direction than it had gone before. And I vehemently preached my heart out that night. And one of the men came up, and his Bible's open, and he's just standing there looking, waiting to talk to me. And I'm talking to some other people in front of the pulpit. We're talking, service is over, and he's just waiting to pounce on me. And I'm thinking to myself, what can he possibly do? And I said to him, well, brother so-and-so, I hope you were able to follow my reasoning tonight. He said, no, I wasn't. I thought, man, this was crystal clear. I said, where did you lose my train of thought? He said, when you read your text. What? He says, where is 2 Galatians? Then he laughed at me. I had meant 2 Corinthians, but I said 2 Galatians. And he was just there because he enjoyed things like that. What a relief that he didn't just punch a hole in my, I hadn't left something out. My mind was not so much on one thing that I left all of this out on the other, which we can do. We can be so focused on some things that we leave something out. Textual, and I just a thought here on John 3:16 and 14 through 17. I've outlined it, the typical anticipation of salvation, look and live, which is a glorious passage. You look to that brazen serpent and you lived. Look and live. That's as gospel as it can be in Old Testament typology. Then verse 16, the motivating factor, love, the inclusiveness of salvation, the world, and the character of salvation, a persevering faith, and those derive right from the text. Expository, I've given you my notes. Please don't criticize me too much for this. But I've given you my notes on Psalm 1. And I want to look at that now. Pages 3 through, 11. You see my introduction. And by the way, this became a series. It is possible to preach one message on Psalm 1. But it would be a hurried message. And you would have to spend most of your time in verses 1 through 3 because that is the emphasis of the psalm, is the blessed man, the righteous man, the godly man, not the ungodly. That's all abbreviated in verses 4, 5, and 6. But this is my, I have an analysis of this psalm. So this is my basic outline. The character of the godly, verses 1 through 3. Verse 1, considered negatively. Verse 2, considered positively. Look at verse 1, negatively. The blessed or righteous man is outwardly known by what he does not do. It's all negative. And there's a negativeness to the Christian life, to the life of the righteous. There's a negative aspect. Considered positively, his personal inward life is determined by a right relationship to God through his word. This determines his outward life. The inward life determines the outward life. Considered figuratively, verse 3, the manifestation of a truly righteous life is seen in terms of stability. He shall be like a tree. Consistency, planted by the rivers of water, and fulfillment. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. And then the character of the ungodly by contrast. Considered negatively, the ungodly are characterized by relativism and instability. Where in the world did I get that? Where is that in the psalm? The word for ungodly or wicked means without foundation. The wicked are like the troubled sea when it cannot rest, whose waters cast up mire and dirt. There is no peace, saith my God, to the wicked. And it's the same word, rasha'im. Relativistic would be our modern term for that. They have no foundation, no stability. It describes the day in which we live, doesn't it? And then considered positively, the character and life anticipate the great separation which will take place on the day of judgment. But if, ki'im, but if they're like anything at all, they're like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Considered negatively, considered positively, considered ultimately, a summary statement that anticipates the final day of judgment. That was my outline. And then number three, the subject of this study, the blessed man. Number four, the character considered negatively. And number five, the character of the godly considered positively. And you can get my outline here, the character of the ungodly. But look at this. The text itself, blessed is the man, Ashrei ha'ish, Hebrew plural of intensity. Oh, the complete and utter blessedness of the man. The psalm begins with an exclamation. And I explained this here. Then, look at this. There are six realities in verse 1. His character has been determined by divine grace. His testimony is settled. Blessed is the man who has never walked in the counsel of the ungodly, nor in the way of sinners has ever walked, nor in the seat of the scornful has ever sat. All emphatic in the Hebrew. Anything before the verb is in a position of emphasis, it's all emphatic there. This man's character and his testimony is settled. Number three, his character is distinct. Number four, his life is characterized by a contrast with the ungodly. And I have three things. He does not order his life according to the principles of the ungodly. He takes wiser counsel. He does not unnecessarily associate with sinners. He chooses better company. He does not partake of the thoughts and lifestyle of those who mock divine things. He possesses a higher philosophy and conduct. That's good preaching, isn't it? So this is an expository message, an exposition of Psalm 1 in sermonic form. We have seen his character is distinct. Number C, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. The Hebrew statement, a verbal statement in Hebrew, is verb, subject, object. The verb is placed first in all five of the Semitic languages. So anything before the verb is emphatic. Hakol. Your voice emphatically I heard in the garden, and I was afraid, and I hid myself because naked I am. That's the fall of Adam. Thy voice, hakol, that's emphatic. And you find the emphatic position throughout these verses. And we miss this in the English. We simply don't have it in the English. So we have very strong, pulsating, intense language here. And then his life is... the character of the godly considered positively, verse 2, page 6. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. What we have in the Hebrew is ki'im. I have that on page 7, ki'im. Look at what I have here. This blessed man is a true believer. He experiences true meaning and fulfillment in life. Delight, the word delight, it is just the best there is. But if, ki'im, but if he has any delight at all, it is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. That's his highest delight. Those are the table of sweets at the dinner table. That is soul satisfying. That's the word of God, and it determines his inward life, and that in turn determines his outward life. He experiences an intense pleasure and enjoyment in the word of God. Page 7. The word delight. Chefzo, to experience emotional delight, a longing and a pleasure. The term possesses a note of intensity. And we have all sorts of observations here. Fourth, D, he has made the scriptures his point of reference, the law of the Lord, Torah. Torah refers to the scriptures as instruction, teaching, guidance. We would say the word of God. It's his point of reference, the one great absolute, which gives him his presuppositions, forms his character, and governs his conduct. There's a sermon in itself. And finally, he is assimilating the word of God into his life and experience. He meditates in. And the word means to make a low sound, to muse, mutter, whisper. He's speaking to himself. The Greek word there from the Septuagint, metese means very close to memorize. He's committing God's word to memory. He's going over those phrases of scripture. He's talking to himself. Do any of you men talk to yourselves? Talking to yourself all the time. I argue with myself, talk to myself. Sing hymns. Well, no one's here. I try to sing. I sing hymns and so forth. I muse. I go over these things in my mind, mull them over. We say, this governs this man's life. He's meditating upon the word of God day and night. That means the last thing, he possesses a consistent world and life view at all times. This yomam va layala, that is an idiomatic expression, day and night, meaning all the time, continually. There it is, at all times. He possesses an all-encompassing, consistent biblical world and life view. And it derives from the scriptures. And I think all of this is a legitimate exposition that we have. Then the character of the godly considered figuratively in verse 3. He shall be, his life has a consistency and significance. His life exemplifies the reality of the sovereign grace of God. Bishwati, my friend, it's here, huh? We stayed out till 10 o'clock the last class time talking about this, didn't we? We almost had a watch night service. We left before midnight. And then D, his life is both determined and sustained by divine providence. His life manifests the character of God's grace. His life bears witness to the sustaining grace of God. Do I have another one here? Yes, his life possesses a distinct significance and testimony. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. But look at this. His life has consistency and significance. He shall be like a tree. Now that's significant because a tree is an object of stability. When we go to verse 4, we see not so the ungodly, but if, ki'im, but if they are like anything at all, they are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. The very picture of instability. We have the tree, the tree, the tree. The tree also marked out something. Palm trees were planted by springs to mark out an oasis. You could see them from a long distance. This man has significance in his life. He's outstanding, to pun the term. He shall be like a tree. And then his life exemplifies the reality of the sovereign grace of God, like a tree transplanted. Transplanted, not planted, but transplanted. Look at the footnote on page 9. Transplanted, shatul, occurs only 8 times in the Old Testament, not the usual word for planted, which is nata. Transplanted, didn't grow there by nature. God ripped him out of his native soil and shook off all that dirt and placed him in prime real estate by those water canals where he would be well irrigated all the time. That's sovereign grace. Transplanted. No version of our English Bible, to my knowledge, translates this transplanted. Simply planted. And they missed the entire point. I heard a man so taken up with this from our last lecture that he preached on it last Thursday night as an introduction to his message on Psalm 2. Brother Chris at Pajaro Mission. It was exciting. He was preaching. We would say in the South that you were walking on 6 inches of your britches leg, but you had freedom. And they quieted, oh, what an unruly place, with rock music, the drums, the guitars, and everybody knows what all that was going on, and they quiet down, and you got up to preach, and they listened. And you took out, and I didn't know it, but we looked at it from Randy's cell phone. He had the Masoretic text there. We have Asherei Ha'ish, oh, the complete and utter blessedness of the man. Kiss the son, lest he be angry. Blessed is the man there. Oh, the complete and utter blessedness. Hebrew plural of intensity occurs there too. Asherei. Good preaching. It's the only time they've had preaching from the Hebrew text, as far as I know, unless Jaime's done it in your preaching at Pajaro. We had a good time there. It was a good time. Opening that up, they were fed. And that one student wants a Greek textbook from us. He's just come there. He's been thrown out of his family. He's a white boy. Been thrown out of his family. Drugs, I suppose. And he's just wandering about. I would say he's probably 18, 19 maybe at the most. And we sat together during the meeting and we talked. And he looked. I had my Greek New Testament there. Of course, you were preaching out of the Old Testament that night. I started bringing my Hebrew Old Testament. And I'll have to just bring my laptop. I guess that's the safest, because I can wander through a little bit of Hebrew, but not to the extent I can with the Greek. But we had a great time. The people were fed, and they responded to the message. They received your truth, and they got hold of it. They were able to grasp the preaching, and it was a good time. And they know that every time our men come and preach there, whether it's Jaime or you or Brother Dave, they've been fed. They've heard something of substance. That's a beginning, because that's a very strange place. All right, a tree transplanted by the water canals. His life is both determined and sustained by divine providence. Transplanted by the rivers of water. This refers to irrigation canals, which made this a choice location. Rivers derives from a root, which means to divide, and refers to the division of canals or irrigation ditches, not the usual word for rivers. The tree was transplanted into a rich soil and surrounded by an abundance of water. That's God's grace sustaining. Then his life manifests the character of God's grace that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. Seasonable fruit. Have you ever thought about that? Seasonable fruit. What fruit does my life bear in a time of crisis? How could God allow this to happen to me? That's not bearing seasonable fruit, is it? There's something about true Christianity that's biblical Christianity, that the worse it gets, the closer it draws us to God, until when utterly crushed by some of the worst things we may possibly experience, we simply grasp the feet of our Lord and cling to him and say, Lord, this comes from you. You will sustain me through it. Has that been your experience when you face some life and death situations or possible life and death situations, that your spirit was broken, you didn't blame God, you just grasped him by faith as tightly as you could, and you just humbled before him? That's a mark of grace. All of that's here in this psalm by implication. He bringeth forth his fruit in his season, neither barren nor unseasonable, as as some whose grace seems to be non-existent or temporary. Then I deal with the fruit of the Holy Spirit here by applications. What do we manifest as Christians? And I have an outline for you. One has said that God enables us by his grace to be courageous in trial, patient in affliction, submissive in suffering, gracious in prosperity, zealous in opportunity, and evangelistic in adversity. That was a sermon outline that I got someplace from Psalm 1. It may be out of Spurgeon's Treasury of David, but there's a whole sermon in itself. That's rough, isn't it? What do trials bring forth in my life? What fruit do I bear? So this is fairly rich. Page 10, his life possesses a distinct significance and testimony. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The term prosper means to bring to maturity. Then the character of the ungodly, and it's all abbreviated, considered negatively, the ungodly are not so, literally, not so the ungodly. Locain, not so. Definitely not so. The Septuagint, followed by the Latin Vulgate, uses two negatives. Uk. Uk, not thus the ungodly, not thus. Did you ever consider preaching out of the Latin Vulgate? Not thus the ungodly, not thus. Can I say, Pastor Jakowitz, that the Greek tries to equal the Hebrew but falls back upon its own idioms?
Yes.
Which it does quite often. The Hebrew has a score of ways to show the imperative through the use of intensive particles, interrogative particles, through the imperative construction, and which can be in several conjugations of the verb. The Greek has the aorist and the present imperative, and they always fall back to that. And when they can't do anything better, they just go with the aorist imperative. But they fail to bring the real thought of the Hebrew. Very interesting study. If you're preaching to seminary students, they'll be critical, but you'll still be able to feed them. If you're preaching to normal people, average people, you do the best you can. Sometimes you have to say, this is emphatic. We say about God loveth the cheerful giver. And let me simply give you the word order. A cheerful giver loves God. So we have object, verb, subject, because God is still the subject. And there's no possible way you can put that into English. You just have to let that go. But you explain to the people, a cheerful giver loves God, but God is still the subject. And we have things like that in the Bible. Sometimes you have to say, this is very intensive, or this is very emphatic, and the force is here or there, and just let it go, because the people don't have much understanding. And if you're preaching to a King James only congregation, they are robbing themselves of very much. Because the King James Version is fine for an English version, but is still the English language, and the English language, not the original language. Even though there are some who say that the King James Version corrected the Greek and the Hebrew, so we never really had a true Bible until 1611. Interesting, is it not? But it's very abbreviated, the last parts. Considered positively, but if they are like anything at all, they are like the wind. They are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. You have the ki'im phrase here, but if. It's an acceptive construction in the Hebrew, but if they are like anything at all. But if he has any delight at all, verse 2, it is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Not so the ungodly, but if they are like anything at all, they are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. That in contrast to he shall be like a tree. This is just filled with good things. And if we quit now, why, we're only about 3 minutes over time. I hope it's been a good class tonight. God willing, in our next class, we will deal with topical messages, and I will give a list of texts, and then I will develop them. Just to give you some examples, and we can discuss them. Our assignment for this entire class will be to, on your own, as a paper, be several pages long, maybe not long, but I want a topical message where you take a text and you bring some things, observations or points for that. I want a textual message and then an expository message. And you can copy it from somebody. If you do, note it in a footnote or so. But have the adventure of preparing three messages like this. I'm prone toward the expository preaching myself, because today people are getting very little, if anything at all. And the reason that preachers aren't expository preachers, takes too much work. And they have to deal with things they don't want to deal with. If you preach through a book of the Bible, you have to deal with the difficult passages. And I've seen books of sermons and talked to men who have preached for years and years and years. They take the easy way out. And we shouldn't do that. I think I have enough respect for my congregation to give them the whole counsel of God. And I hope that they have enough respect for me that they know that I will try to do it. May God dismiss us with his blessing, give you all a safe trip home tonight. I trust it's been a profitable time.
Amen. Amen.